Hello again, this is Sean Terry from the Flip2Freedom Podcast, and we are on episode number 138, and this is the final steps in the 9-step seller conversion sequence. We are going to cover step 8 and step 9. So, if you are just listening to this podcast for the very first time, I want to welcome you and let you know that this podcast is about wholesaling houses, flipping houses, using no cash and no credit. When I first got started, I had a preconceived notion that you had to have a 720 credit score, you had to have a pile of money to get started in real estate. But I was driving down the freeway one Saturday afternoon going to an appointment, and this guy on the radio talked about how you could flip houses using no cash and no credit. And he actually had people telling stories of how they made $5,000, $10,000, $20,000 in 30 days or less flipping houses. And I thought the guy was crazy. I thought it was a scam. I thought there was no way that could possibly happen. So driving down the freeway, I flipped the channel back, you know, looking for something else because I was like, what a scam, right? I'm from New England originally, so everything's a scam, right? So I'm sitting there and I had a gut feeling. I was like, you know, I was intrigued. I wanted to know what this guy wanted to talk about. So I turned the channel back and continued to listen. And he talked about a concept of wholesaling houses that I never knew. The only way I thought you could make money in real estate was being a real estate agent or being a real estate investor where you're buying a property, fixing it up, and turn around selling it, like that flip or flop or, you know, any of those TV shows you see on HGTV. You know, or you can buy and hold, where you can buy a property, whether it be an apartment complex or whether it be a commercial property, whether it be just a single family house. So when he talked about the concept of wholesaling, it was brand new to me. So what that means is you can go out and you can target distressed sellers. Now, 95% of the people that are going to sell their property are going to sell retail. They're going to sell retail. They're going to call contact a real estate agent. They're going to sell their property retail, and that's how they're going to do it. But there's a very small sector of the entire population that have houses that are in distress where they are going to sell their property quick, and they don't want to wait 100 days on market. They don't want to have people come through the house. They want to sell, and they want to sell now. So might be a landlord that has a property where the tenant actually trashed the place. It might be a fire damage property. It might be a drug property where, you know, they're doing drugs in the property and the guy was thrown in jail. We've done those deals before. So you never know. There's distress in every type of situation. It could be a foreclosure situation. So what happens is we as real estate wholesalers, we provide a service for those people that are in distress so they can move their properties quickly. So what we do is we market to them, and then what we do is get the property under contract. Now, the 9-step seller conversion sequence we've been talking about in episodes 135, 136, 137, and now the last 138, talks about the process of meeting the seller, getting the property under contract, and that process of what happens in the house with the seller. Talking to the seller, from building rapport, understanding the personality, all the way to getting the contract closed. Now, when we get that contract signed, we have something incredibly important. It's called equitable interest. If we have equitable interest in the property, right, that gives us controlling interest. See, a seller can't sell the property to 1, 2, 3, or 4, or 5 different people. They only can sell to one person. So they can sign a contract with you. So on that contract, let's say you have a $100,000 house, all fixed up, you know, 2017, beautiful granite countertops, all fixed up. But let's say, and that's called ARV, after repair value. But let's say you get the property under contract for $50,000, right? And that's in an as-is condition, so it's not fixed up. It's essentially trashed, right? So you get the property under contract for $50,000, right? And this happens all the time. Now you have a contract. On the contract is the price $50,000 and a closing date, typically 30 to 45 days. And it's important that you have an inspection period for that 30 to 45 days of the term of the contract that allows you to get out of the property if for some reason you can't sell it. Now that you have equitable interest, now you can talk to buyers. You're looking for cash buyers, buyers that use hard money, that want to purchase the property and fix and flip it, or purchase the property for rental purposes. So now you find those. They could be a real estate clubs. They could be down at the auctions. They could be either on Craigslist. They could call, whatever the case may be. You find these buyers and you put the two together. Let's say you get a buyer now for this $100,000 property that you got under contract for $50,000. Now you get it, you turn around and sell it for $60,000. So you got a contract for $50,000. You have another contract for $60,000. You put both of them together. You bring them to a title company, an escrow agent or an attorney, depending what state you're in, and you instruct them to do a double escrow where you use the buyer's funds to close the transaction, or you do an assignment where you sell your contract, or you can use what's called transactional funding. Those are the three ways to actually execute a transaction on a wholesale transaction. Now, in this particular case, you got a contract for $50,000, you sell it for $60,000, that's a $10,000 profit, right? So you make $10,000. What if you did that once a year? Right? You just did it one time a year. You're driving around the neighborhood, you saw a house with tall weeds, it was boarded up and it was vacant. You happen to find the owner, you talk to the seller, you got it under contract, you turn around, sold it, you made 10 grand, you did it one time a year. So here's the question, what would it take on your current job to get a $10,000 a year raise? Right? $10,000 a year, just because you go find a property. Not bad, huh? Now, what if you systemize it, you turn it into a business and you do one deal a month? Well, that's $120,000 a year doing one deal a month. Now, what if you get really good at this and you do 10 deals a month? You do 20 deals a month. That's what we're doing here in Phoenix at Phoenix Wholesale Homes. And that's what my primary business is flipping houses here in Phoenix. And we do a ton of revenue and a ton of deals. So this particular podcast we're talking about is the last step in the series, step 8 and 9, of this 9-step seller conversion sequence. Now, step 1 is preparing your file. Step 2 is the pre-appointment intelligence, what you do before the appointment. Step 3 is actually meeting the seller, strategic leading questions, and actually understanding, building rapport, understanding personalities. There's 4 personality types, you know, and if you know the personality type and you know who you're talking to, it's going to be it's a lot easier trying to negotiate to get a contract. Evaluating repairs, huge, right? You're wondering, how do you get deep discount deals on properties? Well, evaluating repairs, custom covert intuitive presentation. That's where you have an iPad presentation that goes through in every single step about the process of what we do. 3 surefire closing questions, right? You just don't get at the end of after you're talking to a seller and go, you want to sell? You don't do that. No, there's actually closing questions, right? Alternate choice close, fear of loss close, you're closing the personality type. Then there's the objection annihilation method. That's where you box the objection and you overcome the objection. A lot of sellers, what they'll do is they'll say, I want to think about it, right? And if you go, okay, you think about it and I'll call you back later, well, guess what? You're going to lose the deal because the guy like me is going to come in right behind you and I'm going to close that deal. I'm going to overcome the objection. I'm going to get that contract signed. So now we're going to talk about closing the gap, right? And then wrapping up, setting the expectation with the seller. Now, go back and listen to episodes 135, 136, 137, and you'll be able to see the entire process of the 9-step seller conversion sequence. Now, let me set the stage here of basically what's happening. So we as real estate wholesalers, we're essentially marketers. So we are in the business of marketing. So what we're marketing for is getting sellers to call us. If we go out and try to find sellers, that there is a way. I first got started knocking on pre-foreclosure doors. Now, I can tell you that is a method for finding motivated sellers, but it sucks, right? It sucks because in Phoenix, it's hot out, right? And you're sweating. Number 2 is people don't like coming to their house. And number 3 is they have dogs and guns, and that's scary. So the bottom line is that I don't suggest that. I would rather have a seller call me, right? And the way to do that is through either, offline marketing, and there's online marketing. There's a couple different channels we can do that. But let's say we do our marketing, a seller calls in off a postcard or a mail piece or a Google AdWords campaign. They call us, right? And then what we do is we're going to, find out about their story and their motivation, right? And we can talk about another episode specifically about what to say on the phone. But the bottom line is we're gonna book an appointment. And now we're gonna go book that appointment. And this is the 9-step seller conversion sequence that happens after you book that appointment. And then what happens next? how to prepare the file, right? How did the pre-appointment intelligence, what you do when you're driving around the neighborhood so you understand what's going on. Then you're actually walking up to the house, you're knocking on the door, you meet the seller, then what happens, right? Did you know that you could shake someone's hand and know the type of personality type and know exactly how you can work with them to get the product, the contract signed just by shaking someone's hand? Right? Now, then understanding their personality type is incredibly huge. Going around, evaluating the repairs of the property, the closing, and the whole process. So now you're at the process where you've asked the SureFile closing questions. You've overcome the objections. I want to think about it. They go, I want to think about it. Well, what do you want to think about, Mr. Seller? Is it me? Is it the contract? Is it the price? Or is it the process, right? And typically, 99% of the time, they're going to say price. You say, great, what about the price you want to talk about? Right? I offered you, $50,000 and, what do you need to get the deal done today, right? And now what's going to happen is during this process is that either A, they're going to come to a conclusion and they're going to sign the contract, right? So, or B, there's going to be a gap, right? So you're at 50, the seller's at 60. Now, what happens is the gap in what I found is that the gap is sometimes very small. I've been with sellers and I've offered say $50,000, $150,000, $250,000, whatever the number is. And then I say, okay, let me ask you a question, Mr. Seller. What would it take? I offered you, I showed you why with the repairs, with the current comps in the area, where do you need to be to get the deal done today? Right? And guess what? They'll come back. And they'll say, well, you offered me 50, but if you gave me 55, I think I can make that work, right? Okay, well, that's good. You offered 250, but if you gave me 255, I think I've had sellers say that, right? Now, if it works within your numbers, right, and going through the 9-step seller conversion sequence, you'll know your numbers going in. If it works within your numbers, say, great, now it goes to a nail down close. So you're saying, hey, Mr. Seller, let me ask you a question. So if I can get you the 255, I don't know if I can, I gotta make a phone call, gotta look at the property again, gotta walk outside, gotta do whatever I gotta do, but let me ask you a question. If I can get you 255, are you ready to go and get this deal done today? And then you get a yes from them, you get a commitment, and then you can go outside and go look at the house, right? What I'll do is I'll go, I gotta go look at the roof again, I gotta go look at the AC again, let me walk around the house one more time, let me make a phone call. So what I'll do is I'll have our sales guys give us a call, and they'll call up and say, hey, I got this deal, we're at 250, they need 255, and I'll say, okay, get it done. And then they'll go get the contract signed. So what you're gonna do now is you're going to go back, and now you're gonna come back and say, listen, I got the deal at 255, we're not gonna make a lot of money on this, but the bottom line is we gotta get it done today so we can allocate our funds to basically close this transaction. So now, boom, you get the contract signed, you nailed it down, they got the commitment. Because what you don't wanna do is they say 255, and now you, right, go, okay, and then you go outside and you don't get the yes commitment that they're ready to go at 255, you're gonna come back and say, okay, well, I talked to my boss and we can do 255, or I looked at the property, we can do 255, or I looked at the AC, we can do 255, and then they're gonna come back and go, well, I thought about it, I talked to my wife sitting right here, and 255 doesn't work, we really need 260. What happens is if you do the nail down close prior to then going reviewing the property. Now what will happen is it's very difficult for them to change their mind within the 10 minutes you were out walking outside. And how do I know this? Because I've been through it 1,000 times and I've done it both ways. Sellers change their minds, but if you get a yes commitment prior, then they close the transaction. So that's what happens if you make an offer and now you've overcome the objection, the objection's price, and now you go, let me ask you a question, Mr. Seller. I gave you an offer. You understand we're paying cash, right? You understand this is the net number to you. You understand you're not paying closing costs. You understand you're picking your closing date. You understand that, right, Mr. Seller? You got that, right? Okay, great. So I offered you $150, right? Where do you need to be? Where do you need to be to get this deal done today, right? And then they come back and they give you a number, and that number say 155. That's a close gap. They might say now 160. Now, what happens if they say 160? Now you got a $10,000 gap. You gotta look at your numbers. If your numbers works, then you can do the nail down close, And if the numbers don't work, you're still going to do the nail down close, but now you're going to go outside and you're going to go walk the property. You're going to make the phone call. You're going to look at the AC. You're going to look at the roof. You're going to do whatever you're going to do. And now you're going to come back and say, you know what, Mr. Seller, I just looked at everything. You know, I can't make 260 work. I really like the house. I really like you. I don't want to commit to a specific number, 260, and then get myself in a situation where we can't get it done. You wouldn't want that. I wouldn't want that. So why don't we do this? Why don't we split it down the middle? How would you like to split it down the middle? So you get 260. We'll, you know, obviously be in a position, be a little bit tighter on our side, but at least we'll do it. Split it down the middle. It's a win-win situation for both parties. Will that work for you, Mr. Seller? Right? And then shut up and they'll say yes. And they say, great, you can sign the contract. That's if it's like a gap where your numbers will allow you to split it down the middle approach. Now, if you have a bigger gap, so now you're at 150, they want 170, they want 180. Now you have a $20,000 to $30,000 gap. That's not a split it down the middle. That's you're talking $15,000, $20,000 that's gonna be added to your bottom line price. That's gonna be difficult. Right, so now we're working to close that gap the best we can. So now it gets a little bit more, you gotta get in their head and understand why they want, you're at 150 and now they want say 180, right? That's a big gap, right? So that's a $30,000. Is that $30,000 gap? Yeah, it's a $30,000 gap, right? So $30,000 gap. You can't do a split it down the middle because you got, right, $15,000 you can add to your 150 price. That's not going to work, right? So you have to be in a situation where you can go, okay, you know, why do they want the 180? So you go, so let me, and then you go back and reiterate the process, which is, let me explain something, Mr. Seller. So I just want to make sure you understand, you know, because maybe I haven't explained myself thoroughly, but you understand we're paying cash, right? There's no loan fees or any of that type. You understand we're paying closing costs, that's going to save you thousands of dollars. You understand you're not having to fix anything on the property. Typically in a normal transaction, they'll do what's called a BINZR, a buyer inspection seller report, where you're going to have to rock around the entire property. A buyer's going to want, you know, have a ascended inspector, you know, through the entire property. They're going to inspect every ounce of this, every inch of this property, and they're going to come back with a buyer inspection seller report where they're going to come back and they're going to want you to fix everything. You realize we're taking the property in as is condition, and you're not going to have to spend the thousands of dollars that needs on the roof or on the AC or on the outside or this, that. And you're not going to have to do that because we're buying it as is, right? And the most important thing, Mr. Seller, you're not going to have to pay significant amount of money in commissions. This is going to be the net number to you. Now, what I found is if you are talking to a seller and you explain that to them, a lot of times they don't understand the process. So what's going on is they're thinking 180 and they're backing out commissions, they're backing out fees, they're backing out closing costs, they're backing out and they're going, well, I'm going to really get one, you know, 165, 170 maybe. And once they understand that they are going to get a net number of 150 or a net number of 180, guess what? That changes, right? So explaining that in detail, having them understand that is critical for the fact that now you are both on the same page and now you're dealing with straight line numbers, 150, 180, okay? So now you've done all that and now they're at 150 and 180 and their bottom line's 180. Then you go, let me ask you a question, Mr. Seller. You know, what are you gonna do with the proceeds? Right? And now you're trying to find out what they're going to do with the proceeds. Maybe they're trying to find another house. Maybe they have to move. Maybe they have to pay off some debt, you know, whatever it might be, you know? And then what happens is now we have to do a comparison approach of where they're going to sell it with a realtor and then us, right? So in this particular case, now you got to do, listen, you selling it with a realtor and knowing this going in, have an understanding and being able to do this on the fly is incredibly important. But in the covert, custom covert intuitive presentation, we have it structured in a way that would make sense in a logical fashion with the seller. So we have what's called a list to offer price or a list to close price. Now, typically in most markets, you know, depending on what market you're in, you might have a list price and then a close price, right? The list price, obviously, is 100%. The close price, you might be 94% of list price. It might be 90% of list. That means there's 10% coming off the table. So now you go, hey, listen, I know you're going to sell, you know, try to list it, Mr. Seller, for, you know, $190,000. But if you take 10% off the table right there, that's $19,000 coming right off the top because of the list to close ratio, right? And then you're going to have to pay real estate commissions of 6%. You're going to have to pay 2% closing costs. Then you're going to have to fix the property, which is going to cost a couple grand. So even if you sell it with a realtor, Mr. Seller, and it's going to take 111 days, you're going to be at a net number. We're talking like 160. So the 180, the chances of that is pretty much pie in the sky. It's probably not going to happen. Wouldn't you agree with that, Mr. Seller? And they're going, you know, if you show it in a logical fashion, they're going, ah, yeah, you know, maybe you're right. Right? So I'm at 150, you're at 160 down net. I'm talking net numbers here. What if we split it down the middle? Now you've given them a logical reason why you got a side-by-side comparison of their other alternative. Their other alternative is to list it with a realtor. So you show them the other alternative that brings them down to a net that's really close and closes that gap. Boom, now you've closed the gap where you can do a split it down the middle approach. Okay, so that's how you take that. Now, what if they go, well, I got an offer from another investor that's gonna pay 180 and you're at 150? Okay, and sometimes you hate to walk away from a deal, but I would say, are you 100% confident that you got a written cash offer from another investor for full net to you, 180,000? I would question that because I'm an investor, Mr. Seller, and honestly, anybody that's going to write a contract this thing from an investment standpoint, the numbers don't make sense at all. They don't make sense at all. So the bottom line is that two things are going to happen. He's going to tie up your property, and he's not going to be able to do what he's going to do, either fix it, sell it, whatever he's going to do. And then you're going to be stuck with a bag 30 days later, 45 days later, and guess what? You're going to be in the exact same position looking to sell your property. But guess what? The market might shift in that way. My offer is going to be less. So either A, right, we can do the offer, you know, now and get it closed and get it done, or you can really nail this guy down to find out if he can really perform at $180,000. So that's now they have $180,000, close the gap that way. So here's the deal. Now that you've closed the gap, right, and you've worked to close that gap, and you've overcome the objection, and you understand the process, and this is not a confrontational thing. This is not where you're beating them up and rah, 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 rah. This is where you're talking to them and working with them through the process. Now they go, okay, so let's say you do a split it down the middle. You get at 150 and they're at 160. After they, you know, you negotiate with them, you're at the 155. You sign a contract for the 155. You're all good. Now you've essentially have the contract signed. You're golden, right? You're good. You've done what your mission is to do, is get the contract signed. Here's the problem. The thing is that if you don't get the contract signed, someone like me or someone that me that's been following this training is going to go in behind you, and they are going to be tenacious enough, and I call it graciously tenacious, right? So there's being tenacious where you're just like, it's almost like a rock, right? And you take a hammer and you beat on that rock. It might be a piece of granite. And you beat on it, 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 beat on it. And eventually the piece of granite or rock cracks, right? But you have to beat it over the head, you know, 25, 30 times before you actually make an impression or even move the rock to crack. Some sellers are like rocks. They're like pieces of granite. You have to hit them over and over and over and over and over again by overcoming objections and understanding the process and closing the gap and, you know, nail down closes and understand this whole thing. You're hitting them over and over and over again in a nice fashion where eventually they'll crack and you can get the contract signed. Now, it might not happen right there, but it's gonna happen essentially over time depending on their personality type. Now, here's the deal. Graciously tenacious is you do it in a loving manner, right? So what does that mean? Is that if your intent is to go in and I'm just trying to get the lowest price possible and I'm just wanna screw them and get the, that's not the attitude you wanna have. your attitude going in is that you are a service. You're trying to provide a service for them, and you want to be able to obviously make your numbers work, make your buyer's numbers work, and solve the problem for the seller. So if you come from a loving manner where you're, listen, I really want to help you out, and honestly, I'm just telling you, you know, I don't want you getting a situation where you think 180 is going to actually, you know, they're really going to be able to close and make a difference, and I don't think you can get that price, right? So I just want to be straight up with you, because I don't want to, you know, call me back 35, 40 days from now, and I'm not going to be able to honor the same price we have now, right? I want you to be able to get this deal done in a way, and I'm telling you, this is the numbers that work, and this is the numbers we can make it happen, and you can be confident we can get the sucker closed. You know, so wouldn't you want to be confident that you can get the sucker closed and, you know, go reach for something over here that's just like an iffy, right? and you know, that might not happen. You might not close. You might stick it on the market. They might, you know, as soon as they stick the property listed on the market for 180, I'm out, you know, because that sets a price. I'm done. I can't do anything with this property after that. So the bottom line is that if you come in a graciously tenacious, now tenacious means that you are gonna basically set up camp until you get the contract. You know, you're not gonna leave until you get the contract. So that means you're gonna overcome any objection possible known to man to be able to get that contract. Now graciously tenacious means you're gonna do it in a loving manner, right? You're gonna be nice about it. You're not gonna be a jerk about it. All right, so now you've got the contract. You've closed the gap. You overcame the objections. You've done the surefire closing. Well, you're boom. You've got the contract and now it's signed, right? It's committed on both sides. Now you're shaking the seller's hand. Now you want to set the expectation. People ask me all the time, how do you get buyers in to look at the property? How do you get contractors in to look at the property? How do you, you know, how you're able to market the property? How are you able to do that stuff? And then what if the seller finds a listing on Craigslist for the property? Oh my gosh, they're gonna be mad. They're gonna, and people screaming, they're gonna blow the deal. How am I gonna get buyers are gonna come look at the property, and then the seller's gonna freak out if I bring buyers to the property? What's gonna happen? Or if the property's occupied with a tenant, how do I get that, how do I make that happen to where I can get buyers in around the tenant, right? That's all done in the wrapping up and setting the expectation, which is the last and final step in the 9-step seller conversion sequence. Now, setting the expectation comes back to the contract. Now, in our contracts, we specifically say that we are an investor and we're here to make a profit, right? It doesn't say, hi, I'm Sean Terry and I'm gonna live in your property, right? It doesn't say that. It says, I'm an investor and I'm here to make a profit. It says it right there in the contract, and I have them even look at it and here, sign off on it, right? So if they're gonna do that and they know that I'm an investor and here to make a profit, then we don't know how we're gonna make our profit just yet. We might sell the property quickly. We might rent the property. We might fix and flip the property. We might sell it to another investor quickly. Whatever, we don't know what we're gonna do with the property yet. All we know is we're an investor and we're gonna make a profit. The bottom line is you're gonna get your agreed on $155,000 price, and whatever we do with after that doesn't matter. Is that understood, Mr. Seller? So now what happens if you're setting the stage and now they see the property on Craigslist, they're not gonna freak out. Why? You're an investor to make a profit. You told them right up front. You told them what the situation is. You have other buyers coming to look at the property, they're not gonna freak out. Why? Because you told them you're an investor. Now, the other thing you gotta do is you say, listen, for us to complete our file, right? We have to get our file together. So the title company, they're gonna pull a title report. After they get all the title report, they're gonna put all the documents and they're gonna get everything together. Well, they're gonna have their file from all their deeds and their documents and their payoff statements and everything from the loan. They're gonna get their file together, so do we. So for us to get their file together, we have to have our investor partners, our money partners, come through the property and look at the property, right? We might have to have a contractor or two come through the property really quick to come and look at it, and they're gonna do an assessment. And yeah, so there, when would be a good time, you know, or, you know, how is the best way to communicate with you to be able to schedule to have these? We could either A, do it where they all come at once, right? And then you know, you could either be at Starbucks for an hour or two, and then we can have them go through, or you can be there, either or we can have them come at an individual time. Which would work better for you, Mr. Seller, right? So now you're gonna communicate, so that they know. Now, this is after they get the contract signed, now you're gonna walk them through the process of what's gonna happen. Now, if the property is occupied with a tenant, right, it's a different story. Now you're talking to the seller, right? Now you've got to be able to communicate with the tenant. So I'm going to tell the seller, I'm going to say, listen, I'm going to have to communicate with the tenant. We're going to have to get our investor buyers in there. We're going to have to get some of our contractors in there and look at the property. So what is the best way for me to communicate? You know, should I go over there and talk to them? Do you have a phone number I could call them and make arrangements with them to look at the property? Now, every seller knows that you have to do due diligence on the property and you have to get your file. They didn't buy the property sight unseen and they shouldn't expect you to buy the property sight unseen. So you're gonna have to get stuff together to be able to make that happen. So now when you do that, right, you're gonna say, listen, we gotta get our file together, and part of getting our file together is having our investor buyers go out there, have our contractors go out there and basically get a sign off on everything that we're good to go so we can get this funded and closed as soon as possible. The other thing too is that on the contract, it's typically a 30 to 45 day close. Now, what happens is you might wanna, we all try to close it quicker. We don't wanna wait 30 to 45 days. We wanna close it as fast as humanly possible. As soon as we get a buyer on the hook, if we turn around and put it out to market on day 3 and the guy can close on a day 7, now that's 10 days in the contract with the seller, I need to be able to communicate that with the seller so they understand that, listen, it could happen sooner than 30 to 45 days. So what we're going to do is and say, ask Mr. Seller, and say, let me ask you a question. You know, sometimes we need the entire 45 days, 30 days to get this deal closed. Sometimes, depending on the title company, how busy they are, and if everything's clean, we can get the thing done in 10 days. So if we happen to have a chance to close in 10 days, not saying that we are, but if we could you move that quickly? Could we close it that quickly? Could we get it done that fast? Are you willing and able to do that? Now, what they're gonna say is they're gonna say yes or no, I've gotta move out, I need the complete time. Or, yeah, you know, if you can get it done in 10 days, it's a rental property, boom, get it done. I'll sign, I'm ready to go. That is really good information to know. Now you can put it out to the market. Now you can get the thing sold as soon as humanly possible. And remember, the whole goal in this business is to sell and turn over properties quickly. It's called the velocity of money. It turns over quickly. You know, I had a coaching student, one-on-one coaching student, Joe Taylor, right? He came into my office a couple of years ago. He made $311,000 a year as a wholesaler. He was working like 7 days a week. He was, you know, cranking. He was just, you know, didn't have a team, didn't have a system, didn't have follow-up, didn't have anything, right? He was just working all the time. But one of his key factors in his business is he would sign a contract and put a 45-day close, and he would not close until 45 days, right? So I show them basically a math formula, and I said, listen, do you realize that if you moved it down to, say, a 15-day close, what that's going to do for the velocity of money that's coming in, how many more deals you can do, how much more revenue you can produce, how much more you produce more revenue, that means you can produce more money in marketing, that's going to create more deals, it's going to create more revenue. And it literally, with a change of taking it from 45 days to 15 days, on his current business model, increased his revenue from $311,000 to over $1 million in revenue, just by changing one thing from 45 days down to 15 days. So when I'm talking to my staff and my team, we're in our Monday morning meetings and doing our quarterly meetings and stuff, it's like, how can we compress the time from when we sign the contract to when we actually can get it sold and get paid? Because that velocity is key to reinvesting back in the marketing, to crushing the business and growing it. So, a little side note. Anyways, the bottom line is that your goal is to close up. So now you're wrapping up the expectation. You've told the seller, number one, that you're gonna have buyers look at the property. If the property is vacant, then you want to see what, do whatever you can do to get the property in the lockbox. So you say, Mr. Seller, say, listen, we've got some of our investor buyers coming in. We have our contractors coming in. Probably one of the best ways we can do it is we can put it on a lockbox. I'll give you the code. I'll have the code. I'll make sure I am here and I'm present if anybody walks through the property, and I'll take responsibility for anything beyond this point. If you tell them that, then what happens is now it takes them off, and you can have the property in a lockbox. And definitely go down there and make sure that if you got buyers down there or contractors down there, whatever you're going to do, that you're going to be there and be responsible, because you don't want to send someone down there and they have a refrigerator, you know, stainless steel refrigerator all of a sudden shows up missing because you gave someone a lockbox code and someone took the refrigerator out. It happens, but I would make sure you're there so you actually open up the code box, you let them in, you and then come out, because you'll just be safer all the way. Otherwise, you're going to be paying for a refrigerator. So that's wrapping up and setting the expectation. Once you do that, now you're able. Everything, you're setting the stage. You walked them through the process. Now you have a system to talk to sellers and get properties closed. When I first walked in, before I developed this 9-step seller conversion sequence, and I developed it primarily for my sales guys, so they have a systematic approach to follow, right? Now, when I first started doing this, I didn't have a systematic approach. I'd show up and I wouldn't drive the neighborhood and I didn't know the comps and I didn't understand the objections, and I'd go through the house and I'd meet the seller and I'd forget to take pictures and I'd forget to, you know, really look at the repairs correctly or understood how the repairs affected the negotiation process. And I talked to the seller, they give me I want to think about it, and I go, okay, I'll talk to you tomorrow, and I wouldn't get contracts. Do you realize that applying the 9-step seller conversion sequence, if you get one extra contract, right? You know, for your, like, typically the average in the industry is one contract per 25 leads. If you're brand spanking new, you'll get one contract for 25, right? We're typically getting, you know, one contract out of every 8 to 10 appointments that we go on. So now we got, you know, now you get 20, now you're getting 2 to 3 or 4 contracts. If you go on 30 appointments, now you're increasing it. What if, you know, you have the same appointments, you're paying for the same leads that come in, but if you're increasing your conversions, that increases your entire business. You know, getting one extra contract a month, what would that do for your business, right? If you're doing one a month anyways, now you're getting two, that doubles your business, right? If you're doing two contracts, you get three, boom, you're crushing your business down. And that's what growth is. It's being able to take the same leads that are coming in, the same marketing budget, increase that revenue systematically by compressing the time to close, but also two, your contract to conversion ratio. I think our contract to conversion ratio, we did a meeting, was it 14? For every 14 appointments we go on, we get one contract. So 14 to 1. We've even had it as low as 12 to 1, right? And there's some people in the market, it's 30 to 1, where they take 30 you know, leads to get one contract. If you do 12 to 1, that makes a huge difference in your bottom line. And those KPIs, or key performance indicators, are key to know. Okay. So now, that is it for the 9-step seller conversion sequence. Make sure you go back and listen to all 135, 136, 137, and now 138, all these. Listen to them over and over and over again, because once you get this ingrained in your blood and you understand this, you will see massive results in your conversion when you're talking to sellers. And all I can tell you is this, is that in this business, right, in this business, there are ups and downs. It's like a roller coaster. You ever been to Disneyland, right? Love Disneyland, right? So my wife's sister works there. We go there all the time. I mean, I know that place inside now. But they have what's it called? Screamin'? It's called Screamin', right? Yeah, Screamin', right? They got that roller coasters going around and loops and all this type of stuff, right? It makes your stomach go crazy, right? That roller coaster is exactly like this business. You sit back, whoo, it takes off like crazy. So you drop marketing and the thing, it rocket launches off, right? In the beginning, your head just smashes to the seat and you go right into this loop. It takes you around all these curves and swims and up and down, and your stomach's flying. That ride is this business. You go through this emotion. You take off, you drop some mail, you drop 1,000 letters. Next thing you know, you get calls coming in, boom, you're taking off across your seat, your head's against the thing. Holy cow, I don't know what's going on. Then you're going up and down. You get a talk to a seller, and you got 3 or 4 sellers that want to sell. This is incredible. This is amazing. And then you go meet with them, and they all want retail. Then you're going down. Now you're depressed, right? your stomach drops to the bottom. You go, this sucks. I just thought about this real estate thing. Maybe my friends are right. Maybe I should quit. And then what happens? You get excited because another seller calls and they go, hey, they want to sell. And the house is trashed and the place, and it's like whatever. And they go, oh my gosh, it's incredible. Boom, you go shot back up again. And then you shoot back down again. And you shoot around again. See, when you first started, this business is in an emotional roller coaster because you're going up and down and sideways left. You're excited and then you're not. And then you're going to go talk to somebody, right? That's the worst thing. The worst thing is you're so excited and then you go talk to somebody. And then somebody gives you their, not logical, they give you their perspective, right? You know, or their realistic approach of what's gonna happen. Realistic sucks, right? Realistic, no one wants realistic, right? It's not realistic that I do what I do. It's not realistic, right, that, you know, I make more money in a month than the average person makes in 10 years. That's not realistic. So why would you wanna listen to someone realistic, right? So the bottom line is that realistic sucks. So don't listen to realistic, listen to unrealistic. Listen to, you know, and find something that has what you want, do what they do, and you get what they got. The bottom line is this, is that I went out and I talked to realistic people that told me that I am realistically out of my mind thinking that I can flip houses because all the professionals are gonna get those deals. You can't get deals under contract, though. You can't be able to do that. And they were like, they were being realistic. Thank God I didn't listen to the realistic people. Otherwise, I'd be realistically in a job that I hated, right? So the bottom line is you got two different options. You can be A, listen to the realistic, or B, no, be realistic, right? And it is possible. You can flip houses, you can get in real estate, and you can go out and do some incredible things. And that is the beautiful thing about this business. There will be people that are naysayers that don't want you to succeed, because if you succeed, it's gonna make them look like a failure. Well, guess what? Slowly just, you know, unless you're married to them, slowly weed them out, right? So kind of push them off to the side. The bottom line is that it's much better on the other side of realistic, right? It's, life's a lot more fun. You have a lot more cool things you can do. And that's where you want to be. So follow the 9-step seller conversion sequence. You might be, I don't know where you are in real estate. You might be doing 2 deals, 5 deals, 10 deals, no deals, and you're just trying to get involved. Whatever the case may be, have faith. This works. You are in the right place. And guess what? You're going to start cranking, and then your big problem's going to be, where do I put the money? That becomes an issue. So I'm part of, we have a boardroom elite mastermind and billionaire boardroom. We went to Cabo San Lucas with a billionaire boardroom. One of the big problems in that group is, where do I invest capital? Well, in real estate, right? You invest in cash flow real estate. That's the game. So stay tuned for the next episodes. We got a ton more episodes coming. We got some cool stuff coming out. Make sure you go to flip2freedom.com, flip2freedom.com. We got free gifts on here if you go there. You can get this 9-step seller conversion sequence. You can get this in a, and it's actual, what's it called again, Aaron? That thing, what's that called? Think of download that you made.
The infograph?
Yeah, the infograph. Okay, so you can get an infograph of this 9-step seller conversion sequence if you go to flip2freedom.com/gifts, flip2freedom.com/gifts, go there. You can download this 9-step seller conversion sequence infograph. They'll have each step in the process. You can follow it. Also, too, we got live webinars coming up. We got live trainings coming up and all sorts of stuff. And make sure you get plugged in. You listen to the podcast. Friend us on Facebook for sure, because I do Facebook Live videos talking all about this stuff. I just finished up a Facebook Live where I talked about our quarterly meeting and some of the 3 big takeaways in that quarterly meeting. So find us on Facebook. Like us there for sure. Put your notifications on, so when we do Facebook Lives, you can get notified. But definitely go to flip2freedom.com. I wrote a book. It's a 129-page book you can get for free, and you can download it at flip2freedom.com. So until next week, thank you guys for listening. I greatly appreciate it. Go out and crush it. Take care, and God bless. So here's what you gotta do. Click to the left for another episode. Click to the right. You'll hear a killer success story of people that actually have listened and applied the information. And here, click in the middle and you will be able to subscribe. Make sure you do that for sure so you'll get updates on all of our newest, freshest content.